Hey everybody, so today we're going to talk about chapter 5, which is body systems and related laboratory tests. So we are going to review over each of the body systems in this lecture, but I am not going to focus so much on the related laboratory tests other than giving some examples of what some of the specific lab tests in each system might be looking to diagnose, okay? And that'll make sense as we get there. The reason I'm not going to go into detail over all of the related laboratory tests is because there are so many. And as you're reading through this chapter, make sure I'm going to point out for each section which table to reference and what pages in your textbook. You need to make sure that you're going back, familiarizing yourself with some of these common laboratory tests. You don't have to memorize them all. You just need to get familiar with them. Be able to start to recognize them. As you advance in your phlebotomy career as a phlebotomist, you're going to become familiar with these tests more and more as you go. Also, the fact that your assignment for this week is to really dive deep into your own assigned body system and then share it with your classmates, I want to kind of hit some of the highlights of each of these body systems and then let you guys really, again, dive deep into it with your assignment. And I think that will be really beneficial in for you and for sharing it with your classmates. So a few things about body systems. We have 12 body systems there are 12 body systems in our body. Human anatomy and physiology, we've heard of that. Anatomy is basically the study of the structure of our body, whereas physiology is the study of how our body functions. Diseases and disorders of the body are usually classified according to the body system or systems that they affect. And one method for classifying laboratory tests is to organize them by body system as well, which is again how we'll be doing it and how you'll be reading it in your textbook. There's also certain laboratory tests that are ordered. You will see them called test panels or test profiles. Test panels usually consist of laboratory tests that are ordered and associated with one organ or one body system. An example of that would be the hepatic panel, which is done to evaluate the functioning of your liver. Test profiles, on the other hand, are a group of laboratory tests that provide assessment over at least two body systems. An example of that would be a comprehensive metabolic panel. So on table 513 in your textbook, pages 112 through 113, do review that as well. That's going to be some of the most common test panels and profiles that you will come across and start to become familiar with. So I'm going to go and skip our objectives. We're going to jump right into the integumentary system. So this is the largest organ of our body. It encloses and protects all other body systems, contains the hair, skin, nails, oil glands, and sweat glands. Our skin provides protection. It regulates our temperature, prevents water loss, and it also aids in absorption, like vitamin D, for example, and aids in sensory perception, so feel or touch. The integumentary system has several disorders that are related to it, of course. Just a few examples. You've got skin cancers, squamous cell, basal cell, and melanoma, which is the most serious of the three skin cancers, fungal infections, allergies, viruses such as herpes zoster, which is responsible for chickenpox and shingles, measles, and things like ulcers or rashes. So some of the most common tests and or laboratory blood tests or other tests related to the integumentary system are on table 5-1, which is page 91 of your textbook. And these are going to help to diagnose things such as chickenpox or lupus, seasonal allergies, fungal infections, or various skin cancers. You've got your skeletal system. So our skeletal system consists of bones, cartilages, ligaments, and joints. Our body, or our skeletal system, provides the body with protection and support, protects internal organs. It provides a place for muscles to attach so that muscles can move our skeleton, right? Our skeletal system, one thing you want to remember for sure is that it's in our bones that blood cells are produced, minerals are stored, as well as fat and excess calcium are stored. So again, don't forget that the bones produce our blood cells. Some common disorders of the skeletal system include osteoporosis and osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, gout, osteocarcinomas, which are cancers of the bone, and other diseases that might be related to nutritional deficiencies. Some of the common blood and other tests related to the skeletal system would be, here are some examples here, but these are on table 5.2 in your book, page 92. These tests are done to diagnose such things as arthritis, gout, or multiple myeloma, which is a cancer that starts in the bone marrow. Our muscular system. The muscular system is designed to do, well, functions, has many functions. Movement, it helps our body produce movement. It helps our body produce heat, and it helps to support our posture. Muscles basically contract and relax and to do what we want them to do or what they do either automatically or voluntarily. And this is controlled by the nervous system. And that leads into the fact that there are three different types of muscles. We've got cardiac, smooth, and skeletal. Cardiac muscles are involuntary. Those are specifically related to the heart, and it's involuntary, as in we don't have to tell our heart to pump. Thank goodness, right? Smooth muscles are also involuntary. The smooth muscle is what lines the inside of our blood vessels and the walls of our hollow organs. Skeletal muscles are the voluntary muscles of the muscular system. So for example, I tell myself I'm going to raise my arm by my side. That's voluntary, okay? So connective tissue is needed for our skeletal and muscular system to work together. It's important to know what tendons and ligaments are. Tendons are fibrous tissues that attach muscles to bones, whereas ligaments attach bones to other bones. Some common disorders of the muscular system, you got fibromyalgia, myasthenia gravis, muscular dystrophy, sprains and strains, tendinitis. And there are multiple tests done to help diagnose disorders and diseases of the muscular system. These are found on table 5.3, pages 93 through 94 in your textbook. These can help to diagnose things like, again, muscular dystrophy, just muscle damage in general, skeletal muscle inflammation, or things like rhabdomyolysis. The lymphatic and immune systems. So our immune system works with our lymphatic system to clear the body of disease-causing agents. The lymphatic system essentially filters blood and lymph of any foreign substances to get that out. The lymphatic system also helps to maintain fluid balance and absorbs fat from our digestive tract. So again, lymph is basically this kind of clear yellowish fluid that helps to carry disease-fighting cells called lymphocytes, which we'll get into in our next lecture, but helps to carry these disease-fighting lymphocytes to various parts of our body when it's been invaded by a foreign substance, when we have infection, when we need to get ready to fight, right? So lymphatic and immune systems together are responsible for protecting the body against bacteria, viruses, fungi, toxins, parasites, cancers. And it's made up of the lymph fluid, which I mentioned already, lymphatic vessels, lymph nodes, glands, tonsils, thymus, and spleen. You guys are probably familiar if you ever had an infection or just not felt well. If you can feel around here, you might feel some swollen lymph nodes, maybe under the armpits, that get a little bit inflamed when we do have an infection going on. So I mentioned this a little bit already, but together the lymphatic and immune system provide protection by circulating white blood cells and lymphocytes and other antibodies throughout the body. And the cool thing is these antibodies can stay in our body for an extended period of time. And when a foreign substance comes back again, our body already has these antibodies that says, I've seen you before. I know how to deal with you and get you out of here. So some common, I didn't go ahead to that slide. Let me see if I missed anything. I don't think so. Okay. So some common disorders of the lymphatic and immune systems include mononucleosis or mono, HIV or AIDS, allergies, lymphedema, rheumatoid arthritis, ulcerative colitis, different autoimmune diseases. And then there are several tests that help to diagnose diseases and disorders in the lymphatic and immune system found on table 5.4. Pages 95 through 96 in your textbook. These might help to diagnose things such as rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, mono, tuberculosis, or certain cancers. Okay, so our respiratory system. Our respiratory system, of course, is there to provide oxygen to all cells of the body and to remove carbon dioxide. A respiration is the process of taking in that oxygen and giving off that carbon dioxide. The respiratory system is made up of the trachea, bronchi, bronchioles, nasal cavity, oral cavity, and lungs, and they help to maintain the balance of that oxygen and carbon dioxide, as well as regulate the pH of the blood. There are some common respiratory disorders, such as your just general upper respiratory infection, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, or COPD. This includes both chronic emphysema and chronic bronchitis. You got asthma, pneumonia, tuberculosis, cystic fibrosis. So many common tests for respiratory system page, you will find that on table 5.5 in your textbook on page 97. Again, these tests help to diagnose a variety of things such as your general respiratory infection, COPD, flu, RSV, and different types of lung cancers. They can also help to diagnose something called respiratory acidosis or respiratory alkalosis. You'll definitely want to read on that in this system as well as in the urinary system, because actually when it comes to pH levels in the blood, the respiratory system and the urinary system both play a really important role. So definitely familiarize yourself with both respiratory acidosis and alkalosis and metabolic acidosis and alkalosis. It's basically when the CO2 and O2 levels, so carbon dioxide and oxygen levels in the blood are off, changing our pH of our body. So our digestive system. Our digestive system, of course, is responsible for the intake and digestion of food. It also is responsible for absorbing nutrients and removing waste. Peristalsis is the name for the way in which our GI tract relaxes and contracts in a wave-like motion. And this is involuntary. And that's how we help our food move along in the digestive tract. The organs that are involved in our digestive system can be divided into two categories, the alimentary canal and the accessory organs. And as you can see here, the alimentary canal includes our mouth, pharynx, esophagus, stomach, small and large intestines, rectum, and anus, whereas our accessory organs include our teeth, tongue, the salivary glands, liver, gallbladder, and pancreas. So again, digestion is a chemical and mechanical process in which food is broken down and nutrients are taken out. So to recap, the three main functions of the digestive system: digestion, absorption, and elimination. Some common disorders or diseases of the digestive system: you've got diabetes, ulcers, hepatitis, gastroesophageal reflux disease, or you've heard it as GERD. Many different tests, a lot of them, for the GI system, you're going to want to look at table 5.6 in your textbook, and this spans from pages 98 to 100. So this is a pretty big section, but these tests help to diagnose things such as chronic liver disease, pancreatic disorders, type 2 diabetes, colon cancer, and other bacterial infections. Our nervous system. So our nervous system is responsible for both conscious and unconscious action. So voluntary movement, breathing, etc. It includes the brain, spinal cord, and the peripheral nerves. There are actually two major divisions of the nervous system. As you can see on this slide, we've got the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. You do need to have at least an understanding of these, the breakdown of these systems. The CNS, or the central nervous system, includes the brain and spinal cord, whereas the PNS, or peripheral nervous system, includes cranial nerves and spinal nerves. The way our nervous system works is by transmitting electrical impulses. We get an impulse, we send something or get a signal from the environment. We send that impulse up to the brain to be interpreted, and then we send it back out to have a response. You can also have a signal a signal from within your body that sends a signal to your nervous system and tells your body or your organs or your hormones, et cetera, how to react. And it does that. So neurons, which are nerve cells, make up that conduction tissue of our nervous system. And there are three types of neurons. I want to see if that has it on here. Okay, I didn't know if I had put that on there or not. So there are three types of neurons, and you want to be familiar with these as well. You've got sensory neurons, interneurons, and motor neurons. So sensory neurons are in the peripheral nervous system, and they're responsible for taking stimuli from the environment or inside the body and bringing it to the central nervous system. Interneurons are located in the brain and spinal cord, and they're the neurons that interpret the information that the sensory neurons just sent. And then after they've interpreted it, they pass it on to our motor neurons. So the motor neurons take what the CNS just interpreted and they deliver it to the peripheral nervous system, and where glands, muscles, whatever it might be, whatever the appropriate receptor is for that message, reacts to that stimuli. All right. So the amazing thing to remember with this is that total transaction, the entire transaction between neurons, your central nervous system, your peripheral nervous system, take milliseconds. I think one of the best examples I usually give is you touch a hot stove, you pull away. So, you know, in milliseconds. But you think about that has taken the time for you to get that sensory of, oh my gosh, that's hot. It's sent it up to your central nervous system. It's interpreted that message, sent that message all the way back down to your hand to say, get off. Some common nervous system disorders, a CVA or a stroke, Alzheimer's disease, meningitis or multiple sclerosis. Lots of nervous system diseases, tests that you can do to help diagnose diseases and disorders of the nervous system. And you'll find that on table 5-7, which is on page 101 in your textbook. This is going to help you to diagnose things like meningitis, cancer, encephalitis, which is swelling of the brain. All right, let's see. We've got a few more here. We've got endocrine, urinary, and reproductive. So you guys are doing great. Hang in there. We've got our endocrine system. This includes the organs, which when referring to the endocrine system, our organs are also called glands that secrete hormones. That can be the pituitary, the ovaries, the testes, the pancreas, et cetera. You see the list here. Something important to remember is the pituitary gland is kind of a special gland. It's considered sometimes called the master gland of the body. And that's because the pituitary gland actually has quite a bit of control and influence over the function of many of these other glands. So the endocrine system controls the function of our organs and tissues at a cellular level. Again, these glands secrete hormones that target certain cells and tell those organs and cells what to do. Hormones, like I just mentioned, hormones are basically, again, chemicals that are secreted and they help regulate chemical reactions within a cell. Hormones are released, they enter the bloodstream, travel to that target cell, and the cell is either stimulated or inhibited by that hormone and again tells our body what to do. So, a couple of examples of that. Insulin is a good example of that. Insulin is secreted by the pancreas and it's secreted to decrease glucose levels in our blood. Oxytocin is another good example. Let's take a breastfeeding woman. When she is breastfeeding, oxytocin is released to induce milk production. So there are some common diseases and disorders of the endocrine system. Examples might be diabetes, Addison's disease, Cushing syndrome. And when we're talking about diabetes, keep in mind there's type 1, type 2, and gestational. Oh, and one thing I was going to tell you, table 5-8 on page 102 actually has a more detailed list of all the glands of the endocrine system and the specific hormones they produce and the actions that occur when those hormones are secreted. So review over that as well. Now, some of the more common blood tests or other tests related to the endocrine system are on page 103 through 104 in your textbook, and that's table 5-9. These different tests might help diagnose things such as Addison's disease, which I mentioned, Graves' disease, goiters, which have to do with thyroid, thyroid cancer, diabetes, or different types of cancers of those specific glands. All right, so our cardiovascular system. Oh, I think I forgot about that one, but we'll touch base on this quickly because the entire chapter 6 is over the cardiovascular system. So in general, of course, the cardiovascular system, also called the circulatory system, is made up of the heart, blood vessels in our blood. It is responsible for sending blood to the lungs to get oxygen, then to the digestive system to collect nutrients, and then to deliver those oxygen and nutrients throughout the cells of the body. As the blood is traveling through the body and going to those cells and dropping off oxygen and nutrients, it's also picking up carbon dioxide and other waste products to get filtered out of the body. Some common disorders of the cardiovascular system include angina pectoris, cardiomyopathy, which is heart, like an enlarged heart, emboli, which is a clot. You guys have probably heard of atrial fibrillation, infarct, which like a myocardial infarction and a heart attack, or murmurs. Some common tests of the cardiovascular system. You will find this on table 510 in your book. And pages 105 through 107. Again, this is quite a lengthy table. So definitely take some time to review this. Some of the tests that you may be performing will help to diagnose things such as sickle cell disease, septicemia, anemia, cancers, hemochromatosis, which is too much iron in the body, and many, many more. All right, moving on to the urinary system. This is made up of the kidneys, the ureters, the bladder, and the urethra. The urinary system is responsible for the removal of metabolic waste from the blood. It also helps us to maintain proper balance of water, salt, and acids in our body fluids, and it removes excess water from the body. Like I mentioned earlier, the role that, the urinary system also plays a big role in pH balance of the body. And this is, again, where you're looking at metabolic acidosis and metabolic alkalosis. Blood pressure. And because the urinary system plays such a big role in maintaining the balance of waters and salts, et cetera, in the body and removing excess fluids, the urinary system also has a large role in our blood pressure. Let me see if there's anything else I wanted to. Another interesting role that the urinary system has is that it's actually our kidneys that produce erythropoietin. Erythropoietin is what stimulates the bone marrow to produce more red blood cells. So if you have an issue with your kidneys and they're not producing erythropoietin, therefore your bone marrow is not getting the signal to produce more red blood cells, that's going to affect the amount of red blood cells in our body. And that's a whole other, you know, cascade of events and an interesting thing to look into some more. Proper function of the kidney is vital for all of these reasons for homeostasis of the body. Homeostasis, of course, is just balance. Some common urinary system disorders include chronic kidney failure, kidney stones, cystitis, which is a bladder infection. And like I've already mentioned, the metabolic alkalosis and acidosis. Some common tests for the urinary system, you will find that on table 511 and page 109 in your textbook. These are going to help to diagnose things like kidney failure or kidney stones, among others. All right, the last system, we've got our reproductive system, and this is broken down into the female and male reproductive systems. So our female reproductive system consists of ovaries, vagina, uterus, mammary glands, and other accessory structures. The female reproductive system, let me see if I have that on that. No, okay, go back. Produces, or basically is the site of fertilization and fetal development. It signals the body to produce milk, and it releases the hormones that influence both our sexual function and our sexual behavior. Whereas the male reproductive system consists of testes, ducts, the penis, and other accessory structures, the male reproductive system produces and transports sperm, and of course generates the hormones that influence sexual function and behavior as well. Common reproductive system disorders, infertility, various sexually transmitted infections, and cancers of the various reproductive organs. Common blood tests, you'll find this, blood and other tests, you'll find this on table 512 on pages 110 through 111 in your textbook. And these various tests diagnose and or help to diagnose and differentiate various things. But a couple of examples would be like prostate cancer or cervical cancer. All right, you guys, that was a lot of information. Good job hanging in through all of it. And I think you guys are gonna do an amazing job with your anatomy and physiology assignment. And this will really help to, you know, get this in the head a little bit better. But again, please review the various common tests and blood and other tests performed, as well as those common test profiles and test panels. And that is it. So thank you for listening.